Thank you. Listen to these words from 2 Corinthians chapter 1. I'm going to skip through a little bit. Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of mercies and the God of all comfort, who comforts us in all our affliction so that we may be able to comfort those who are in any affliction with the comfort with which we ourselves are comforted by God. Our hope for you is unshaken, for we know that as you share in our sufferings, you will also share in our comfort. For we do not want you to be unaware, brothers, of the affliction we experienced. And then later on, you also must help us by prayer, so that many will give thanks on our behalf for the blessing granted us through the prayers of many. These words were written by Paul. He was a man who experienced much affliction, and he was no stranger to hardship and persecution. And yet he was able to stand firm, unshaken, because he built his life on the solid foundation of Christ. And we just sang, "I will build my life upon Jesus," in the last song. We're going to sing about together as the body of Christ, singing, "Glory, glory, hallelujah, he reigns."
Good morning, everybody. He does reign, and love just singing that song where it's like all the different tribes and nations and corners of this world just praising our God. And this Sunday was a designated day of international prayer for the persecuted church. And so we're going to be watching a video in a moment and praying for them. But first, I want to welcome each and every one of you here. All the regulars, great to see your faces. If you're a guest with us this morning, so glad that you joined us, and just pray that you can fit in the body of Christ and just have your heart lifted up. A couple of things coming up to draw your attention to. November the 16th is a church business meeting, so mark your calendars. You can check out information on the back bulletin board if you want to see more of what we'll be talking about there. And a newcomer's dinner coming up November 18th. If you're newer to the church, haven't been to a newcomer's dinner yet, come on out. There's a little flyer in the back that'll give you the information for that. And I can't not mention the gingerbread house competition December 3rd. It's coming. Posters will go up this week, so that'll be good. We're now going to watch the video to just draw our attention to the persecuted church around the world, and then we'll pray for them.
Can you think of a situation in your life where, in the heat of the moment, you felt all alone? Maybe you felt like God was far away, but when you looked back, you realized that God was with you every step of the way, that He was close and present. Learning to seek God through the difficult seasons of life is an important part of the Christian journey, and it's one we often can't do alone. We need to support each other and pray for God to bring His peace and wisdom to challenging situations. In fact, many of our brothers and sisters in Christ are in need of prayer today. There are more than 360 million Christians around the world that face high levels of persecution and discrimination simply because they choose to follow Jesus. Persecution isn't only violence. It's also pressure that could be applied to every area of life. Some are kicked out of their homes and turned away by their families. Some have their houses searched and get interrogated. Some are arrested and spend years in prisons away from their families. Churches get attacked and destroyed. People are threatened by their communities. Some get kidnapped and held in isolation. Some live under constant watch, forced to keep their faith a secret. Like in Afghanistan, for example. Afghanistan is the most dangerous place in the world for Christians to live. Almost every Christian there is a secret believer. If a new Christian's faith is discovered, they can be disowned by their family and community, or even killed in the name of honor. Many believers are forced to flee the country, leaving everything they have behind. Christians in Nigeria face the most violent persecution. While all citizens of northern Nigeria face threats and violence, Christians are often specifically targeted by extremist groups because of their faith. They live their lives under constant threat of attack, and kidnappings are becoming more common. An attack could happen at any point of their everyday lives without warning. Each one of these persecuted Christians are part of the same body of Christ that we are part of. Their experiences impact them deeply, and they, like us, need reminders of God's closeness. For this year's International Day of Prayer for the Persecuted Church, will you join us in prayer? Let's pray for our persecuted family to be reminded that they are not abandoned by God or His church, that they are persecuted but not forsaken, struck down but not destroyed, not abandoned.
Let's spend a moment in prayer. It's hard to imagine, isn't it? Being in a place where persecuted for the faith, especially coming from a country where we have many freedoms, but we don't want to take our freedoms for granted because ultimately our freedom's found in Christ. And even those in countries where there is no freedom, they're still free in Christ and they have a great freedom and a great joy. But let's pray together for those around the world now. Father God, we know that, yeah, you You care for those who are hurting and broken. Jesus said, blessed are the persecuted, and the churches around the world have great hardships, a great persecution coming against them. We want to lift up believers in Afghanistan before you. May they stand firm in their faith. May you encourage them, surround them with your hope. And we just pray that they find joy in the freedom in Christ, even when there's no freedom in their country. We pray the same in Nigeria, Lord. May you take your believers and just unite them in you and love, that they'll pray for their enemies. They'll forgive those who harm them, and their faith in you will grow and will spread, and that in the persecution that your church would flourish. Think of ourselves as a church, and I pray that we wouldn't elevate freedoms in the country above a freedom in Christ, but that we would look to you and we would live our lives fully for you, against hardships, against people that frown upon our faith, but that we would stand firm in you and that we'd continually remember to pray for those around the world. We ask in Jesus' name. Amen. In the back, we do have some sheets of paper talking a little bit more about Afghanistan and Nigeria, so you can pick those up and take those home just to remember to pray. And something I love about our church is that, we love the world. We have our missionaries around the world. We pray for the persecuted. We also love our own nation and people around here. Our youth a couple of Sundays ago went and did a service trip in Victoria. So one of our grade 12 students, Emma, she's going to come and share for a moment about that trip.
Hi, I'm Emma Mulhall, and I'm a grade 12 student who is a part of Oasis Youth. A few weekends ago, we went down to do a service trip in Victoria, and we went to the Central Baptist Church and got to know their youth group. There are many highlights, from our prayer walk and conversations to dance parties and pizza parties, but the biggest highlight was learning what it meant to truly be in service of God. We had the pleasure to volunteer at the Compassionate Resource Warehouse, a charity whose mission it is to gather and provide resources for international relief. They have sent 525 shipping containers to over 60 countries since their beginning in 1999. While folding and packaging t-shirts, my friends and I were venting about the stresses we face in our life. And in that conversation, our friend Marissa had a little epiphany and that we know we are very fortunate to live in Canada, but we often get wrapped up in our own issues and we forget how lucky we are, and especially on International Day of Prayer and watching that video, that's very true, how fortunate we are. And from then on, with everything we touched, we really felt and comprehend that it was going to somebody who was really in need of it. And that night, through small group discussions, we talked about what it meant to be in service of God through being in service of those in need. And we have something truly special at Oasis Youth, and I'm endlessly grateful for that trip and the youth group as a whole. Thank you.
So we heard a great story. Now let's watch a short video about their trip.
one. Happiness. Turns out all I needed was the love you came to give. There's nothing else I tried that ever made me feel like this.
Smile.
If songs with feelings were, then I'd call this one happiness.
Not the video.
You wish you were a teenager again? This time we're going to dismiss the kids to Kids Quest. Didn't forget about you. And we'll continue worshiping our God in song.
Please stand with us as we continue to sing. Praise the Lord for all the things he's doing in our church community and also all over the world.
The one true God over all the earth, our King and the Father's love, who became our sin to save and to overcome by your glorious name. By your glorious name.
Give you praise this morning. We celebrate your name in Jesus' name. Amen. 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 You may be seated.
morning, church. When is the last time you had to take a test? I was thinking back. In life, there's been a lot of tests I've had to take, whether it's been in school, college, or just life in general, tests that you come across that you got to prepare. And I don't know about you, but whenever I had to write a test, there's always a bit of anxiousness that I got. Was I studying the right things? Did I understand the concepts that they wanted me to understand? Was I competent in the things that I'd be testing on? And you know that, right? If you had a test, you're going, okay, did I do okay? And when you're finished studying and you've written the test, you're going, oh, I can't believe I forgot that, right? It's like grasp. And the reason that we have tests is because people want to see what your understanding's like. They want to see if you're competent in any given area. Are you going to be able to do what is required of you? Do you have the knowledge? Is your knowledge adequate? As we continue our series on who God is this morning, we're going to be looking at the fact that God is all-knowing. God is all-knowing. Psalm 147 and verse 5, it says, "He, great is our Lord and abundant in power. His understanding is beyond measure." In 1 John 3:20, it says, "He knows everything." In Job, another statement is made. In Job 37:16, it says, "He is perfect in his knowledge." Incredible characteristics, beyond measure, knows everything, perfect in knowledge. The only one that all those things can be said about, the only being that those things can be said about, is God. No one else. And so this morning, as we consider that God is all-knowing, what does the fullness of this attribute mean? What is it really saying? What is it trying to communicate? What does it mean for us today? The fact that God is all-knowing. When a statement is made that God is all-knowing, it means that he never needed to learn. What he knows now, he has always known. Because God does not change, he has always been all-knowing. He has never learned anything from anyone, nor is there anything for him to learn. There's nothing for him to discover. He is never surprised by anything. He's never amazed by new information. A.W. Tozer wrote this: "Could God at any time or in any manner receive into his mind knowledge that he did not possess and not possessed from eternity, he would be imperfect and less than himself." Always. Had all information. Put it in a little more simpler way, Andrew Wilson said this: God never needed to go to school. God never needed to go to school. There is no job for which he is not qualified. He has never lost his keys. He's never forgotten someone's name. He's never gotten his words wrong. He's never worried about what will happen tomorrow. Because God does not accumulate knowledge. For God, knowledge is intuitive. He has always had all knowledge. So unlike us. So unlike us. When is the last time you were wrong? Or maybe I should ask the question, when is the last time you were willing to admit that you were wrong? When is the last time you overlooked a detail in something and you made a mistake? When is the last time you found out some information you didn't know and you needed to change your mind? Because of lack of knowledge or foresight, we have these issues all the time. Not so with God. Because God's knowledge is absolutely perfect. He knows all there is to know. And whether we like to admit it or not, we are dependent upon other people. We're dependent upon plumbers, mechanics, bakers. When is the last time you went to your computer and you Googled information on how to do something? When is the last time you went to your computer and you went to watch a how-to video because you weren't sure how you should do something? Or maybe you just simply went to somebody else and you said, can you give me some information because I'm really not sure how to do this. This is way out of my league. We are so dependent on others. In fact, there are times, many times, that we stake our lives on the fact that somebody else knows how to do something that we don't know how to do. Every time you get into an airplane, you trust that that pilot knows what he's doing. Every time you pick up a prescription from the pharmacy, you trust that the person that handed it to you knew what they were doing, because you don't go home and check out the pills and go, is the right medicine in these things? We are willing to stake our lives on the knowledge that somebody else has because we do not have that knowledge. To say that God is all-knowing means that God does not need to learn, nor has he ever needed to learn. It means that his knowledge is absolutely perfect. The word used to describe the all-knowingness of God is omniscience. Again, a word made of two words, omni being all. Every time I hear that word omni, it just blows me away, because I remember a number of years ago, Dodge made a vehicle. It was called an omni. It was supposed to be everything, but it was actually nothing. Omni, everything. And science, which is knowledge. The word omniscience refers to God's perfect knowledge of all things, both actual and potential. He has not learned and cannot learn. He doesn't go to anyone. He has no advisors. He does not need to consult with anyone. He does not need to gain understanding. He is never at a loss. He is all-knowing. Again, in such a contrast to who we are, because for the most part, we're born ignorant. We spend our lives learning. We learn how to walk, talk, some read, some write. We go through life trying to overcome our ignorance. How do we parent well? How do we do so many things well? Because we can always keep on learning. There's always so much more to learn. Have you ever made this statement? If I'd only known then what I know now. Right? Why? Because it shows us that in learning, we still have so much to learn. And as we step into learning, we think, man, the more we learn, the more we realize we don't really know anything at all. John Piper said this about the knowledge of God. Listen to what he said. God's knowledge is unfathomably deep. He knows all recorded facts, all the facts stored in all computers, and all the books in all the libraries in the world. But vastly more than that, he knows all events at a macro level. All that happens on Earth and in the atmosphere and in the farthest reaches of space, in every galaxy and star and planet. And all events in a micro level. All that happens in molecules and atoms and electrons and protons and neutrons and quarks. He knows all their movements and every location and every condition of every particle of the universe at every nanosecond of time. And when one event happens, he sees not only it, but he sees the eternal chain of effects that flow from it. And from all the billions of events that are unleashed by every other event, he knows all this without the slightest strain on his mind. You get that? So when we talk about the fact that God is all-knowing, when we talk about the fact that God is omniscient, what we're saying is there's no limits. He knows it all. He's got it all covered. When we consider the all-knowingness of God, there's four things about his knowledge that show us, I believe, how vast his knowledge is, how big, how expansive his knowledge is. God fully knows himself. Think about that for a moment. An amazing fact. God, eternal. God, the one who is infinite, knows everything about himself. Fully knows himself. Let me ask you a question. Is there anything, one thing, just one thing, that you know everything about? No. Not even one thing that you know everything about. There's always more to learn, there's always more to discover, but not so with God, because God knows everything about all things, including himself, fully known. 1 Corinthians 2 and verse 11, it says, no one can comprehend the thoughts of God except for the Spirit of God. Again, A.W. Tozer writes this. He said, God perfectly knows himself, and being the source and the author of all things, it follows that he knows all that can be known. How do we even begin to wrap our minds around that? How do we even begin to try to comprehend all who God is and all that God knows? Because God is so incredibly big. And I was thinking about that statement, God is so incredibly big. That is such a minimalist statement in comparison to who God is. We can't understand him. God is such a complex being, and what we know about God is only possible because of what he's revealed to us in creation through his word and through Jesus Christ. In fact, we could learn about him for all eternity and still never comprehend all that there is to know. Each day in eternity could be a new discovery, a fresh understanding, but not so with God. Because God fully knows himself. In fact, I think there's going to be times in eternity when we won't need to learn anything new of God because we will simply be in awe of what he has already revealed. And like those around the throne that we read about in Revelation, there will simply be amazement and wonderment to who he is. Along with fully knowing himself, God also knows all things actual. He knows all things that have taken place, all things that are taking place, and all things that will take place. He knows us in every corner of the world, and not simply in our lives and those around us. In Isaiah chapter 46, verses 9 to 10, it says this, remember the former things of old. For I am God and there is no other. I am God, there is none like me. Declaring the end from the beginning. God is always fully aware of everything. Job 28 and verse 4 says, for he, God, looks to the ends of the earth, and he sees everything under the heavens. God knows everything perfectly and completely right now. Because he is infinite and his understanding is infinite. He knows everything about every person alive, some 7.8 billion plus people. A number in itself that we have a hard time understanding and fathoming. But more than that, he knows everything about every creature that lives. In Colossians chapter 1, it says, all things were created through him and for him. He is before all things, and in him all things holds together. God knows the actions of all creatures, not just humanity. Hebrews 4 and 13, it says, "And no creature is hidden from his sight, but all are naked and exposed to the eyes of him who we must give account." But not only is he aware of the actions of every creature that lives, he also knows every thought of everything that is alive. Ezekiel 11 and verse 5, when speaking to the people of Israel, God said this. He says, "For I know the things that come to your mind." Again, I think it's impossible for us to grasp that. It means that nothing, not even the things that go through your brain that you have no idea what's going on, nothing is beyond God. He knows all things that exist and all things that happen. But more than that, God also knows all things that could possibly happen. Because God fully knows himself, he knows everything that he is able to do, which includes all things possible. God knows all things that will happen, but he also knows all things which would have happened in different circumstances. Wayne Grudem, in his book, Systematic Theology, wrote this: "God has an incredibly complex and varied universe. But there are thousands upon thousands of other variations or kinds of things that God could have created but did not. God's infinite knowledge includes detailed knowledge of what each of those other possible creations would have been like and what would have happened to each of them." Things that could have been but were not. I think of the story or the movie Christmas Carol. Ebenezer Scrooge is taken up by the ghost of future to come, right? This is what could happen. But did any of those events happen? No, they didn't. But there were possibilities. What he saw was what could have happened. God's knowledge sees all possibilities. It's like a person who's really good at playing the game of chess. And in their mind, they try to see all the possible moves that their opponent could make, when in reality, only one of those moves will be made, but they can imagine them all. In life, God knows each of these potentialities, even though only one will actually happen. Because if God didn't know even one fact, he would not be the all-knowing God that we believe him to be, and the Bible declares him to be. Fourth truth that shows how vast God's knowledge is that it's not confined to things on earth. It's not confined to the physical realm. In Psalm 147, verse 4, it says, "He determines the number of stars." Any idea how many stars are out there? The number is absolutely mind-boggling. Approximately 200 billion trillion stars in the universe is what they think. Another way of saying that is there's 200 sextillion. Means nothing, does it? That's a 200 with 21 zeros behind it. That's more than there are grains of sand. Scientists believe that they estimate there's 7.5 sextillion grains of sand on the earth. Doesn't compare to the amount of stars they believe there are. And this is what we're told. He gives to each of them their name. God's knowledge is not confined to the things in our tiny little planet, to our solar system, to our galaxy. It's so much bigger. He also knows all things that have happened and will happen in the spiritual realm. The Bible tells us that Before the beginning, God knew that Jesus would be delivered up to be crucified. He knew that God would raise his son from the dead so that we could have forgiveness of sin, that sin could be paid for and death would be defeated and Satan would be defeated. Again, A.W. Tozer writes this, as we think about the completeness of God's knowledge, he said, God knows instantly and effortlessly all matter and all matters. All mind, all spirit and all spirits, all being and every being, all creaturehood and every creature, every plurality and all pluralities, all law and every law, all relations, all causes, all thoughts, all mysteries, all feelings, all desires, every unmuttered secret, all thrones and dominions, all personalities, all things visible, invisible, in heaven and earth. He knows motion, space, time, life, death, good, evil, heaven, and hell. He knows it all. He truly knows the past, the present, the future, all thoughts, all possibilities. It's no wonder that in Romans 11:33, Paul wrote these words. He said, "Oh, the depth of the riches and the wisdom of God." And so I think the question we're left asking ourselves is this: how should the fact that God is all-knowing, that God is omniscient, make a difference in our lives? If you have your Bible, if you have your Bible on a phone, go to Psalm 139. Because I think it takes this concept of the bigness of this attribute of God, his knowledge, and the fact that he knows all things, and it brings it home. Psalm 139, verse 1, it says this: "O Lord, you have searched me and you know me. You know when I sit down and you know when I rise up. You discern my thoughts from afar. You search out my path and my lying down, and are acquainted with all my ways. Even before a word is on my tongue, behold, O Lord, you know it altogether. You hem me in, behind and before. Might want to just turn off the remote mics on the side. Power bar on the side. There we go. Such knowledge is too wonderful for me. It is high. I cannot attain it." These verses speak about God's knowledge in us. Despite the fact that God's knowledge is infinite, despite the fact that God's knowledge is beyond our understanding, what these verses tell us is these verses say that God's knowledge and the fact that he knows us is also personal. It's personal. These verses confirm to us that he knows us. What David writes about his relationship with God here is true of our relationships with God. He has searched you. He knows you. He knows your every action. He knows when you sit down. He knows when you rise up. He's acquainted with all your ways. He knows all the tiny details of your life. In fact, Jesus said in Matthew 10:30, he knows the number of hair on your head. No time for any jokes. But along with knowing the actions and the details of your life, he also knows, what you're thinking. Verse 2 tells us that he can discern our thoughts from afar. Verse 4 tells us that even before a word is on your tongue, God knows what it is. He knows what you're going to say even before you say it. He knows the thoughts that you have that you're not even going to speak out. He knows the thoughts that come to your mind, and he knows how you're going to express those thoughts. In Matthew 6 and verse 8, Jesus says, he knows what you need even before you ask. He knows everything about you right now. He knows where you're sitting. He knows if someone's watching online. He knows what you're thinking about as you're listening. He knows even if you're not listening. He knows if right now you'd rather be somewhere else. He knows what you're going to do after we're finished meeting this morning. In fact, he not only knows this about you, but he knows this about everyone. The reality is he knows your whole life. He knows how long you will live. A little bit later on in the psalm in verses 15 and 14 down through verse 16, it says, I praise you, for I am fearfully and wonderfully made. Wonderful are your works. My soul knows it very well. My frame was not hidden from you when I was being made in the secret, intricately woven in the depths of the earth. Your eyes saw my unformed substance. In your book were written every one of them, the days that were formed for me when as yet there were none of them. He knows it all. If you're a follower of Jesus Christ this morning, or if you will be a follower someday, he knows that. Ephesians 1, 4-6, it says, even as he chose us in him before the foundation of the world, that we should be holy and blameless before him. In love, he predestined us for adoption to himself as sons through Jesus Christ, according to his purpose. He knows it. We don't understand it, but he knows it. He knows you, knows your thoughts, he knows your whole life. And this morning, he understands you. He knows what you need, even when you do not. He knows your feelings. He knows your struggles. He knows what brings you joy, because he understands you completely. He knows you better than you know yourself. Nothing can be hidden from him. He knows our desires, our excuses. He knows our personalities. This morning, he knows your pain and your heartaches. We cannot hide these things from him, even though we try to hide them from others. In difficult times in life, he knows. Dr. David Jeremiah wrote, our God knows what we are going through. He knows every minute of our pain and our suffering. He not only knows what we feel, but he also knows why we feel what we feel. He knows how it happened, how long it's going to last, and how intense it will be. He knows every emotion associated with it. And when you are going through such difficult times, all you can do sometimes is look and say, Father, you know. You know. He knows our hearts. He knows our sin. Psalm 19 and verse 8, it says, you have set our iniquities before you, our secret sin in the light of your presence. He knows things about you you thought nobody knew. He knows things about you that you would be embarrassed if somebody else found out. He knows things about you that maybe you thought you had gotten away with and no one knew, but he does. And he reminds us that if sin is an issue for us right now, the best thing for us to do, because he knows us, is to come and to lay it on the table and confess it and give it to him, because he's promised forgiveness. He knows. There is no man that can expose you for something that God does not know. Satan cannot blackmail you and say that you are not good enough because God already knows you. And the amazing thing is this. He knows everything about us. And he loves us. Even though God knows all that we have done, will do, yet he will forgive. Even though he knows there's times that we will slip up, yet he is patient. An absolutely incredible thought, having the knowledge that our Heavenly Father knows us completely, that there are no hidden secrets with God. No unsuspected weakness in our character can come to light that will surprise him. Because he knew us completely before he called us to himself in the full knowledge of everything that was against us. In Romans 5:8 it says, but God demonstrated his love for us in this, while we were sinners, while we were enemies, while we were in rebellion, Christ died for us. And if you ever wonder if God could forgive you or accept you, know he can, and he does when we go to him. Isaiah 54 and verse 10 says, for the mountains may depart and the hills may be removed, but my steadfast love shall not depart from you, and my covenant of peace shall not be removed, says the Lord who has compassion on you. As we consider the fact that God is all-knowing, but yet still cares for us, it should cause us to come to him in worship. To adore him. We should praise him for extents of his mercy and grace towards us. It should bring us comfort, because despite the fact that he knows our faults, he loves us, and he has a plan, and his plan is to make us more like his son. And more than that, he has a plan to use you for his glory. In Ephesians 2:10, it says, for we are his workmanship, created in Christ Jesus for good works, which God prepared beforehand that we should walk in them. Because his plans are good, we don't have to fear. Because his plans are good, we do not have to be anxious. We do not need to be overwhelmed, but instead we can find comfort that God knows what is best for us, even when things do not make sense. In times of confusion and bewilderment, in times of weariness and weakness, in times of doubt and skepticism, in times of failure, in all these things, God invites us to come to him. Isaiah 65 and verse 4 says, before they call, I will answer. While they are yet speaking, I will hear. And so the question this morning is, what do we do? What do you do with the all-knowing God? The one who knows all things. What is your response? And lastly, this morning, if you are walking in relationship with God, do you have a friend who needs to know? To know that there's an all-knowing God who desires to walk in relationship with them as well. Let's pray. Father God, we come before you this morning. And the facts that we have talked about, I believe, truly are mind-boggling. So far beyond our understanding and comprehension, but God, you have shown us enough through creation, through your word, through your son, that we recognize that, God, you are the one who fully knows all things. God, you see us totally laid bare, and I pray that, God, we would be honest with you, and that we would continually come before you and desire to know you, desire to walk in a way that is honoring and pleasing to you. God, that we would stand totally abandoned of all things in our lives, that you would be lifted up and honored. And God, if there are things that we struggle with this morning, that we would give them to you, that we would confess them, we would release them, that we would desire to walk in the power of your Spirit that is currently and presently at work in our hearts. And God, we pray all these things in your Son's name and for your glory. Amen.
Will you join us as we sing one more song in response to the knowledge that God is all-knowing?
Thank you.
great week. There's coffee and tea downstairs. And remember our great God who is all-knowing.